התורה tells us ושמחת בחגיך. Book of Dvarim, Deuteronomy, chapter 16, Pasuk, Yudalet 14. התורה said, ושמחת בחגיך, אתה ובנך וביתך, עבדך ועמתך. The Torah go at length to say it's a mitzvah to be happy and glad doing the festivals, and not just yourself but also each and every one of your household. And the first discussion is what exactly the Torah meant when they said v'samachta. Every person have a different way to be happy. One person is happy by sitting with a group of people and singing. Another person is happy by eating meat. Another one is happy by drinking wine. There are people who are happy only if they get a new jewelry. So that's the first discussion. Then we have a very interesting discussion in regard to the measurement. As you know, several days ago we discussed zayit, the measure of the olive bar. Now we're going to discuss revi'it, which is when we measure that so many things, for example, the measure of cup, the measure of if a Nazirite who forbids to drink, he drank, etc. All these different measurements in the Torah, how exactly you measure a quarter. Then from that we're going to have discussion regarding to mikveh in conjunction to Beit HaMikdash. And then we'll go, time allowed, to the mitzvah of the Arba Kosot. The Mishnah said ve'lo yifchatu lo, we give a specific measure. What exactly that mean? So again, we are on page Kuftet 109. Nine lines from the top of the page. Tanu Rabbanan, Chayav Adam Lesameach Banav. A person has an obligation to gladden, to make happy whom? His children. Uvnei Beito. Guess what? What is Uvnei Beito? Who knows? What is Uvnei Beito?
Household.
Which is what? His wife.
His wife. It could also be...
No, Uvnei Beito usually they meant...
Just,
the Talmud
just the
have many times a nice way to say things.
Okay.
You know, they use the term bait, beito, to his wife, to a person's wife. Baregel, each and every three festivals. Shenema, as we said, v'samachta bechagecha. You should be happy and glad. And as we said, all day least. Now, 2 points. First, Tosfot. Tosfot explains that the meaning of Vesamachta Bechagecha does not apply the way we thought, which is just a be glad and a happy in a festival. But said is about Maaser Sheni, the second time. Tosfot said that that's the meaning. But anyway, the Rambam, it's a very interesting Rambam. Rambam said that it's applied also Bnei Banav. So it's like grandchildren, which is like a little awkward. So there is a book called Matei Ephraim who said that it's a mistake. So you remember the ancient time, they copy. And when they made those copies, up to 1484, in Gutenberg, all this printing press was made basically by hand. So the magia, the person who did it, put it vav bet bet, and it means uvnei beito, but somebody messed up in the way that they copy. And the, if you see the new Rambam, Frankel, so he did just his right lehedia that it's Bnei Banav. Anyway, so there is a discussion Gemara in Rosh Hashanah, just as a side note, page 6b, the Gemara brought the machloki, the disputation between Rabbi Zera and Abaye in regards to what exactly Bnei Beito, the wife, what exactly you make the wife sameach, be glad, be happy. Is that something that it's a obligation upon the husband, or upon herself? Take for example, if you giving your wife a piece of jewelry, so do you need to bother to go to a store and purchase it, or you can give her the money and let her purchase it by herself? So it's a two different view, Abaye and Rav Zera. Anyway, back to our subject. The Shagat Aryeh is a big mahalach on that. Bameme Samcham, which way you make them happy? So the Tosefs said that each one of them Barauilem, the way that they befitted them. But the Gemara tells us Bayayin. So it's giving wine. Rabbi Yehuda Omer, as we said, Anashim Barauilem, Venashim Barauilem. Or there is another girsa uktanim baraulai. So it means that each and every one, according to the way that they, it's befitted for them. Now, anashim baraulai, how you make the men the way that it's appropriate for them? So the Gemara said, bayayin. Yosef must probably have something to say with this. But anyway, right? They said, "V'yayin, v'nashim b'mayin." How you make the wives happy? Tani Rabbi Yosef bebavel bebigdei tzivonim be'eretz Yisrael bebigdei pishtan megoatzim. So it's a disputation. Rabbi Yosef said in the Braita that in Babylon they bring them gadim tzivonim. It's a colored cloth. So the Gemara said in Nida 61 that that's the way they did it over there. Now Shagat Aryeh said that in those days in Babylon they couldn't make ironing properly. They don't have the machine. So therefore they make them happy with this tzivonim. Be'eretz Yisrael bebigdei pishtan megoatzim, says there's a press linen cloth that are manufactured there. So again, it's a different Shagat Aryeh said that it's a better quality. Now I ask you a question. Shagat Aryeh asked, he said, look, biblically speaking, the writer, so there's nothing there that speaks about wine or clothes or anything else. You can sit in a group of people and sing songs and be happy. So he said it's a big discussion. If a person fulfilled the mitzvah, he understand that, for example, I don't know if I'm a good example, but if you give me a choice between sitting with a group of people and singing versus drinking a cup of wine, assume everyone know that I prefer to sing. Mm-hmm. So, anyway, he said when it's God, the Shagat Aryeh said it, that we understand, since it's derivative from the Torah, you don't have a clear statement of what type. So he said it's applied to a lot of things. Women, for example, he said, is not necessarily clothed. We can give her some nice jewelry, etc. Tanya, Rabbi Yehuda ben Betera Omer, Bizman shebet ha-migdash kayam, ein simcha ela bebasar. When they have the Beit HaMikdash, so the celebration, the gladness was with meat. Meat applied to the korbanot shlamim, the peace offering. Shenemar, the Torah said in Dvarim, Deuteronomy 27, וזבחתה שלמים ואכלתה שם ושמחתה לפני השם אלוקיך. The Torah said, and you shall sacrifice peace offering and you shall eat there, and you shall rejoice before the Lord your God. So the truth is, Tosfot tells us, and Rashi in Sukkah in 42 tells us as well, that this pasuk is not applied to the Simchat HaRegel, the festival celebration. But when the children of Israel, it's like instructions, they're going to pass the Jordan River and they're going to enter to Eretz Israel, they're going to build an altar in the Mount Eival, and they're going to have a great rejoicing by having the peace offering, the sacrificial offering of the peace offering, and then they eat their meat after they put the stones that of the Torah. It's written in 70 languages. So since there it's written that we have to be glad and happy for eating this meat of peace offering, we derive from that, when it's come to, it's like a derivative sort of juxtaposition, like since the Torah tells us over there that we have the obligation to be happy with that meat, so the same here, that the gladness of the festival is by eating a peace offering. Now, what we understand? We understand, אבל עכשיו, and now, שאין בית המקדש קיים. Now, since we do not have the Holy Temple in Jerusalem, so we cannot bring this offering, אין שמחה אלא ביין. The way to rejoice, the mitzvah, to rejoice on festival, is only by drinking wine. Shenemar, as it's written in the book of Psalm 104, Ve'yayin yesamach levav einosh. The wine that gladdens the heart of man. So what we see here, that the obligation, Tosfot said, and others, that it's the obligation to be happy is not only and solely in the Beit HaMikdash. So it was said, "Hainu bazman hazeh," in our times with the wine. "Aval bizman Beit HaMikdash," when the time of Beit HaMikdash, it was only in meat. That's the Tosfot way of understanding. So. The other Tosfot, Moed Katan, said that it's only rabbinic. Anyway, there is a Beit Yosef and a Tur. Beit Yosef said that it's specifically with wine. The Tur said it's not necessarily wine. So the truth of the matter in nowadays, when you talk price, the price for meat and the price for chicken, what costs more? You know, in some places, can go the other way around. So we, in a final halacha, later you see that the simcha is both meat and wine. Now there is a Chazon Ish, have a some type of uncertainty. He left it open. I saw it in the Chevrusa, in the book, that that Eliot has. Over there, he brought a Chazon Ish. I don't see the source, but, you know, it's a Chazon Ish. He said that the mitzvah of eating that meat and wine, is that applied to each and every seuda? Like in Chol HaMoed, if you eat breakfast and you're eating lunch. So you need to have meat and wine. Oh, it's applied once, it's applied just at the Moed, and not Chol HaMoed. So that's what he brought there, but he didn't bring the soul. So anyway, Amar Rabbi Yitzchak. Now it's a discussion regard to the measurement of Revi'it, the quarter. Kasta de Muyasa Dahava Bet Tzipori. So it was a city called Tzipori, and they have a way to measure brine. So there was the same Yihavad kemin luga de mikdasha. The same value as the log in the Beit HaMikdash, in the temple. So it means this type of brine was made a combination of salt and water that you put there the fish, intestine of the fish, and because the fat stay there for a long time until they absorb the fat. So he said it was a special utensil in a temple that have the size of log. And that way, by measuring the quarter from that, we know what was the size in Beit HaMikdash. Uva mesha'arin revi'it. So you basically divided that, the part in the utensil 2-4. So you receive the quarter. So you basically divided it, the four pieces. In other words, you take the measurement of that utensil and you take it and you divide it, speaking in liquid, but you see the quarter, and that's the amount that you need for the four cups of Shel Pesach, the wine you need for the Arba Kosot, which is again Revi'it. So basically we derive from that the concept of Revi'it in Arba Kosot by taking the measurement of Beit HaMikdash, Luga de Magdisha, dividing it to a 4, which is application to each cup, and that the way you know that that's the measurement of Revi'it in each and every cup. Remember, we so far speaking about ancient way of measuring. So, Amar Rabbi Yochanan, Tamnaita Kadmaita Dahava Betveria. At that time, they have two different measurements. One is the city of Tiberias. So that's basically the old one. And the new one was smaller than the old one. Havat. They have the Rashbam have a long explanation what is that measurement, the Tosfot too. But anyway, he said Yateira al dar riva. They have an addition greater than the other measure, the eighth measure, by 1/4 log. And he said Uva mesha'arin revi'it shel Pesach. So the way to measure is it's you filled up this tamneyata, and you measure it compared to the new one, and the distance in the measurement between the old one and the new one is a space. What left over is revi'it. So again, you take the old one, you put it in the utensil of the new one, and there's a revi'it left in that utensil. And that's the one who needs for the four cups. Now, that's the way Rashi and Rashbam understand. I must say that if you want to spend another about a half hour on this sugya, I believe that it will take us at least 10 minutes to explain the Rashi, another at least 10 minutes to explain the Tosfot, and another 10 minutes to explain the Chochmat Manoach. So since we are pressing time, I suggested if you want, you just read, or we have it in another session. Now, here we go to a little bit concept of measurement. Amar Rav Chisda, Revi'it shel Torah etzba'ayim. The quarter log measurement of the Torah is 2 finger breadth by 2 finger breadth in volume. Now, berum etzba'ayim v'chatzi etzba v'chomesh etzba. So he said by the height of 2 finger breadth and 1/2 finger breadth, and 1/5 of the finger breadth. So, for example, we mentioned earlier the Nazirite. The Nazirite forbids for drink wine. You deserve Malkodi for that. So the Mishnah said in Nazir 34 that that's the measurement of Revi'it. That's which we call Halacha Moshe Sinai, that we receive that tradition. Or you can have it in Halachot of oil, that Nazir needs to bring those offering. So again, it's all derivative from Psukim that become Halacha Moshe Sinai. So here he said that that's the Revi'it, which is Tefach is 4 fingers. So he said that when it's come to this Revi'it, he takes the measurement. If you see that the numbers, it's basically 2 by 2 by 2.7 fingers, and it's altogether 10.8 fingers, and that's you derive, that's what they need. There's a basic for the mikveh. So you see how Kedetanya v'rachatz b'mayim et kol besaro. The Torah tells us that someone who's involved in ritual impurity, so he shall bath all his flesh in the water. It's in the Vayikra, Leviticus chapter 15, sentence 16. Rashbam tells us, very important, he said, "Mayim amyuchadim shenikvu mitchila me'atzmam." The Rashbam derives from the word "ba'mayim" with the "ba," not "be'mayim." Ba'mayim. What's the difference between "ba" and "be"? So he said, "Be'mayim." You may think that they just take a shower or use just regular water, because it was said b'mayim, it means that it designated water for mikveh, for ritual purity. So we derive from that shelo yehed davar chotzetz bein besaro lemayim, that they should not have anything interposing between one's flesh and the water. B'mayim, when we say that they have to duck himself in the water, we derive from that it has to be b'mei mikveh. So that's specifically in the water of the mikveh, the water of ritual bath. Et kol besaro. So, by the way, what do you think other than mikveh? Maim shuvim, that you just bring water from one location to another. So he said, et kol besaro. So, for example, if you have a pit that have a raining water, so it's a question: is that totally fine for mikveh or not? In general term, it looks like it's good. But he said, et kol besaro, all his flesh. That teaches what? That b'mayim kol gufo ole bahen. That's applied when a person totally immerse with the water and the whole body can enter at once, which means if you have a small amount of the mei shamim, of raining water, you cannot say, okay, I'm putting half of my body and then I'm going to back and taking the other half. It has to have the entire body. V'chamahen. So now tell me, how much is that measurement of the water? Kuftet amud bet, ama al ama berum shalosh amot, a cubit by a cubit, by a height of 3 cubits. Average person, Tosfot tells us, when he doesn't have his hand totally attached to his body, is 1 ama. And the heights, it's basically 3 cubits. So here we speak about average person when he dug in a mikveh. Basically, we should know that, as I said earlier, there is a mahalach here, explanation of Rashbam, of Tosfot, חוכמת מנוח, תושבות, תושבות, תשובות תשבץ, and much more. So for sure, it's above the scope of this study, but we just give a general statement, ושיערו חכמים שיעור מי מקווה 40 שעה. So to wrap up everything, the sages hold, and that's the way the Mishnah Berurah take it, and he said that the measure of the water necessary for the mikveh, for the ritual bath, is 40 se'ah. So the etzlach go a little further, but basically we go by the minimum with it, 40 se'ah. Now, the key is, we want the person who dug there to change his status from being impure to pure. So that's the minimum amount. How much is it? That the quarter of the eat of this, it's ba'ayim, it's the way that we said it is, it take 4 by 4 by 6, so the 40 se'ah is the 3.840 quarter, so it's 40 by 96. Anyway, it's a long one. So we just give them the key point. Amar Rav Ashi, Amar li Ravin Bar Chinana, Shulchan Shel Mikdash. So they have the golden altar in the Beit HaMikdash. And Torah tells us that they have to be Amataim Orko, they have to have 2 cubits, Ve'ama Rochpo, and we have 1 cubit, they... ועמה וחצי קומתו, and his heights, it's 2.5 cubits. של פרקים אבא. So it was basically portable, in a sense, you can pull out the pieces of that. So it's like 2 pieces of the table, you know, those tables that you can match together and put. So they said, דאי סלקה דעתך, הדוקי הווה מהדק. So it means that if it was only 1 piece, you cannot separate it. Ama be'amta heichei madbelei. How cool the Kohen immerse a cubit in a cubit. Because you see here the dimension of the table.
Right.
And it's 2 cubits by 1 cubit.
Right.
With heights of 1.5 cubits. So basically in order to reach that, you have to have the measurement to... Now, the truth is that there is a big machloket. What exactly it means, Amat Binyan? It's between Rab Meir and Rab Yudah. Rab Meir hold that it's a 6 hand breadth, Rab Yudah said it's 5. So the Rambam tells us in Elchot Beit Abkhira, and that's the way the Kesef Mishnah understand that we follow Rab Meir. So if you go that way, it's Amat Kelim, it's a 5 tfachim, 5 hand breadth. So that's, we derive from that Rambam, the Kesef Mishneh, yes, the Reaya, that that's the way that the Amat Kelim was the same as Amat Binyan. So the Gemara asks, my Kushya, what's the question? Why is difficulty? Dilma Biyam Sheasa Shlomo, Hava Matbele. So they said to us in the Book of Kings, the first books of Kings, chapter 7. So King Solomon make like a sea, it's like a man-made sea that was made out of copper in the courtyard of the Beit HaMikdash, of the temple. And it was a special mikveh that was made for the Kohanim. If you go to Yerushalayim, there is a certain area outside of the center, you see that it's called the Breichot Shlomo. So there is the Tosfot explained, follow the Yerushalmi, that they made it in a certain way that the Kohanim can go and duck themselves in that spot outside of the because it was a very large one. דתנה רבי חיה, רבי חיה said the right, הים שעשה שלמה מחזיק 150 מקווה טהרה. So the sea that King Solomon built contained the volume of water of 150 ritual purification baths. So it was possible to immerse even large vessel in the sea. In general, mikveh, it's a place that you have a collected water. Mikveh tahara, ritual purity of mikveh, has to be 40 se'ah. So they in the Book of Kings they said that they alpaim bat yachil, bat is a 3 se'ah. So it means that that sea, it was 2,000. It's a 6,000 se'ah times 40. So that's the if you want to know the exact weight, they put the Meforshim on Gemara and Reuven. We studied page 14. You see the exact way it was. But anyway, we go back to the Mishnah. ולא יפחתו לו מארבע כוסות. He said that if you have a very poor person, very fellow Jew, that it's it depends totally upon charity. So the gabaim, the people in charge, you should not give him less than 4 cups of wine. So here the Gemara dealing a little bit with the concept of zugot. In general, the Torah forbids us any type of sorcery, any type of black magic, etc. So one of the things is that offering to those. There is a machloket between Rambam and Ramban, if that is a real one or it's not. In other words, if a person, according to Ramban, for example, Nachmanides, a person has the capability to force those impure forces to do certain things that naturally cannot be done. And that's what the Torah forbids. So in other words, a charlatan or a person who is in a way wicked can use all kind of things like science, using part of the body, etc., etc., to do things against nature. And the Ramban said that it's possible, but for sure we're not there. We all of that is basically forbidden. So the Gemara derived from that the key is that is a in a way undermine the Hashem, the Almighty capability, when you use it. A person should not involve it. So when you use the term pairs, zugot, it means that those pair. So it's applied to several avenues. It's applied to food. It's applied to other things that they use. In a sense, with those forces. So the key is that anything that exposes a person to a danger should avoid it. If you get used to eat some unhealthy food, you should be careful. But here, they speak about the concept of shniyut. Just give you a vignette of that. Shniyut means that you see a person have two eyes, two legs, two hands. So it was a school of thought that said that it's like two entities that control the world. And that's something that we, the Rambam tells us in the 13 principles of faith, that's not in the spirit of Judaism. In Judaism, we hold strongly that there is only one God and only one, the monotheistic belief. So anyway, the Gemara said, Heiche metaknei Rabbanan, Mide de ate bale de sakana. How the sages instituted something that the person avoiding from exposing himself to danger, said, Ve'atanya lo yochal adam trei, ve'lo yishte trei, ve'lo yikanach trei, ve'lo yase tzrachav trei. So they said that the person should not eat pears, which means an even number of food items. He should not drink pears or cups. He should not wipe himself with pears, and he should not attend his sexual needs in pears. So the concern that one who uses pears expose himself to sorcery or demons. So why would the sages require one to drink an even number of cups and thereby place himself in a position of danger? So again, as I said, that's the general concept of dangerous applied to many ways. So he said, Amar Rav Nachman, Amar Kra, Leil Shimurim, Leil HaMeshumar Uba Min HaMazikim. He said that when we use the term Leil Shimurim, that it was watchful night, that's applied to the night of the Seder, the Torah said in Exodus 12, night of watching to Hashem, to the Lord. So that's indicated that Passover night is a night that remains guarded from demons and harmful spirits of all kinds. So you shouldn't be worried about any dangers in that particular night. Another option, Rava Amar, Kos Shel Bracha Mitztaref LeTova VeEno Mitztaref LeRa'a. He said when you have the cup, you drink the grace after meal, the Birkat HaMazon. So when you do that on Passover night, it's used in the performance of additional mitzvah, and it's not just expression of freedom. So therefore, it's combined with the other cups of wine, which means to fulfill the mitzvah of drink for cup, and it's not combined for the bed. So it's not the danger of drinking pairs of cup. So one drink, three cups. So so in general, if you remember when we study brachot, it's a big question, do you need to have a cup for the Birkat HaMazon or not? But anyway, Ravina Amar, Ravina goes in different direction. He said, Arba'a kasei takinu rabbanan derech herut. So this cup, four cups, that the sages instituted, it's a manner of demonstration of freedom. Kol chad v'chad, consequently, each and every cup, mitzvah be'apei nafshahu, it's a separate mitzvah, but its own right, which means we treated each cup in a separate way, separate, which is the first cup is for the Kiddush, the second cup is for the Agada, and the third cup is the Birkat HaMazon, and the fourth cup is for Hallel. So since they are instituted separately, you don't combine them as a pair. So the Griza Levi explained when he dealt with this Rambam that the essence, the foundation of this idea of four cups, it's in order for us to feel the concept of freedom. So we do it in the kosher bracha, that it's like act of freedom. Now, since we treat each course separately, each cup separately, so therefore you have no concern over pairs. Lo yaseh tzrachav trei, one should not attend to his sexual needs in pairs. So the Gemara asks, amai? So the Rashbam said, nimlachu, they said, the Gemara said nimlachu, you see the Rashbam, the tashmish rishon gamra briato batel ta'avato. The Rashbam said that the moment the person have relations, and then he is already, the desire is gone. So therefore, it's considering as a single, not as a pair. Amar Abaye. Abaye explained, Hachike Amar, Lo yochal trei ve'yaseh tzrachav, ve'lo yishte trei ויעשה צרכיו אפילו פעם אחת, דילמה חליש ומיטרה. So again, that speaks about the value of the body. Since the tashmish, the sexual relation cause a person to lose strength, and he is exposed more, that's the way Rashbam understand it, to the dangers of the pears. So therefore, if someone ate in pear, he needs to wait a long time before engage with relations. That's the Rashbam understanding. Tanu Rabbanan, sages teach us, Shote kiflaim damo berosho. If one drinks in pear, his blood is upon his head, which means he bears responsibility for his own demise. So the Rashbam explains that the damo berosho is come from the Yehoshua chapter 2, that's the language they use. Anyway, Amar Rav Yehuda, Eimatai, when that apply, Bizman shelo ra'a pnei hashuk, which means he didn't move from his location between the first and the second cup. Aval ra'a pnei hashuk. However, if between the cup, they use the term view the marketplace, which means that it's a like separation. Hareshut beyado, shouldn't concern about the pear, can continue and drink. So you see in some Haggadot, the Mefarshim said that that's the reason why they opened the door the moment that they put the four cups, because the minute you see the marketplace, so the dangers of the pear is no longer applied. Anyway, Amar Rav Ashi, Chazin alei l'Rav Chananya bar Bibi, de'akol kasa hava nafik, v'chazei apa deshuka. So Rav Ashi said, I saw Rav Chananya bar Bibi, he followed the policy that upon drinking each cup, he will leave the house and view the marketplace. So again, is the school thought of the Maharal and Ramban that there is a concern. So you make this separation. Velo amaran. And we say that this concern of safety for one who drink in pairs. Ela latzet laderech. Only if a person goes in a journey. Aval bebeito. If he stay in his own house after he ate those pairs, lo. We have no concern of dangers. Omar Rabbi Zera, velishon kelatzet laderech dami. If you go to sleep, it's the same as you go on his journey. Amar Rav Papa, velatzet lebet hakise kelatzet laderech dami. Someone needs to use the bathroom, it's the same as you go on his journey. It's the same category. So the more ask, Rabbi Beito, lo. So in his home, there is no concern. Said those pair can damage him. So he said, "V'harava manei kishuri." So in that time again, that it's a different concept. But the Rashbam said that when Rava drank in his house, he used to use his walls in his house to remember how many cups he drank. So like he sit in a house, he said, okay, 1, 2, 3, 4, and he count those to remember. Not only the time that he needs to go to his journey, just the way he did it. So he said, V'abaye kishate chadkasa man kitle ime tre kase bitre ade. His mother hold the two cups in two hands. V'ram nachan ba'itzchak yav v'shade tre kase man kitle shamae chadkasa. So in, again, you see here a derivative that it's a three, and it's again the dangerous of the pen of the pairs, of the two. Using the mother, you know, Abaye was an orphan in a very young age, so that's the idea of a mother. So a few places. So the Gemara said here you see that it's even a person is his own home, it's still dangerous for him to drink for the pears. So Moses said, you know what? Adam chashuv shani, an important person is different, which means that concern of this different mazikim, different demons that they focus attention to him, it must therefore be more careful than the average person. So it's so that applied to a specific person. So the Gemara said in Brachot that we have to separate in a category, like bride, groom, Torah scholar versus others. It's two different categories. Let's go to practical lachot. So we mentioned today the different school of thought in regard to simcha. In general, the mitzvah of v'samachta b'chagecha should be happy in a festival, according to Shagat Aryeh, can be in many different ways. But the way that we understand, following Shulchan Aruch HaOr HaChaim 529, one is obligated to rejoice in a festival and to ensure that his wife, children, and all of his dependents are happy as well. So on these occasions, one is also obligated to support orphans and geirim and widows, etc. But we explain that the different concept of simcha, if you follow the Chazon Ish, he said it has to be meat and wine in every seuda. we talk also about mikveh. What chatzitzah betvila, what is the interpose? If the majority of one's body is covered by a substance that is not care to remove, or if the minority of one's body is covered by a substance he wants to remove, this covering constitutes an interposition and invalidate his immersion in a ritual bath. So basically a person should be careful, even like a watch, thing like that, take it. Because the immersion is valid only if a proper ritual bath is made, and also a proper ducking in that. That's a Shulchan Aruch Yoredea 198 and 201. The measurement of the mikveh we discuss also today. The minimum dimensions of a mikveh, of a ritual bath, are 1 cubit by 1 cubit by 3 cubits, which means that that's what we call 40 se'ah. A ritual bath does not actually need to be a square or match these particular dimensions. If it contains a volume of at least 40 se'ah, and one can completely immerse himself in the water, so it's fit to use. That's Shulchan Aruch Yoredea 201. We also discuss the concept of kos shel bracha, the measurement, and we said that there is a different opinion between Chazon Ish and Rabbeinu Chaim Na'eh. But in general, we divided those cups, each of them as a separate one. We cannot combine them or do it in a subsequent order.